Welcome everybody. Today we are going to discuss the last part of the chapter Cell, the Unit of Life, chapter 8, class 11th, Biology. So let me tell you what we are going to discuss in this session. We will be discussing cytoskeletal structures, cilia and flagella, centrosome and centriole, nucleus, microbodies, spherosome, glyoxysome and peroxysome. So let us start our discussion. So before starting, let me again tell you what are the structures present in the eukaryotic cell. So we have already discussed the cell envelope, that is cell wall, and cell membrane or plasma membrane, and we have already discussed the cell organelles like endoplasmic reticulum, Golgi apparatus, ribosome, lysosome, mitochondria, chloroplast. These are the cell organelles, and you know that the cytoplasm is having cell organelle and cell inclusions. So we have already discussed the cell organelles, and today we'll be discussing the appendages like flagella and cilia, and microtubules and microfilaments, which are the cytoskeletal structure. And then we will discuss the nucleus, which is the control room of the cell. So cytoplasm, what is cytoplasm? I have already told you. So here you can see that today we are going to discuss the most important part of the cell, that is the control room or brain of the cell, that is nucleus. And besides that, we will be discussing the cytoskeletal structure, which provides a framework to the cell. Okay. So, cytoskeleton. What is cytoskeleton? In a eukaryotic cell, a framework of fibrous protein elements are present to support the extensive system of membrane. So, we have discussed the endomembrane system. So, if the cytoskeletal structure will not be there, then there will be no definite shape of the cell. So, that's why the presence of cytoskeletal structure is very, very important, which consists of fibrous protein elements. And these fibrous protein elements are of different types, and they are collectively known as cytoskeleton of the structure, so of the cell. So, as the skeletal system of our body provides the mechanical support as well as framework to our body, similarly, the cytoskeletal proteins or the fibrous protein also provides a framework and mechanical support to the cell. So, there are three types of cytoskeletal structures. They are microtubules, microfilaments and intermediate filaments. So, let us discuss the cytoskeletal structure, each type of cell cytoskeletal structure individually. So, first one is microtubules, which was discovered by D. Robertis and Franchi in 1953. And it was first discovered in the axon of medullated nerve fiber. You know that the nerve fiber has three parts, axon, dendron and cyton. So, axon has a covering when there is a myelinated sheath on the action, then that nerve fiber is called medullated or myelinated nerve fiber. So, this structure was first observed in the axon of medullated nerve fiber. So, that's why it was named as neurotubules, because it was first observed in the nerve cell. So, it was named as neurotubules by D. Robertis and Franchi. These microtubules are electron microscopic structure, very, very small in size, and they are found only in eukaryotic cellular structures like cilia, flagella, centriole, basal body, then astral fibers, spindle fibers. So, these are mainly made up of tubulin protein. Very, very important, children, you have to remember the composition of microtubule is tubulin protein. I am repeating, the composition or the microtubules are made up of the protein tubulin. Okay, now let us discuss the function of these microtubules. These microtubules, as I have told, they are the cytoskeletal structure. So they provide shape to the cell, provide mechanical support to the cell, and they are present in the cilia and flagella, so help in locomotion and feeding. The microtubules of asters and spindles, you know that during cell division, some fibers are formed to hold the chromosome in position. So they are also made up of the microtubules. So these microtubules helps in movement of chromosomes towards the opposite pole in cell division. So in cell division, that is cell and cell cycle chapter, we'll be discussing how the movement of chromosome takes place during cell division and how the spindle fiber hold the chromosomes in a particular position. So that we'll be discussing in respective chapter. Okay, so see, this is the picture of the microtubule. You can see this is the structure of a microtubule, which is a tubular structure, and it is composed of the proteins. So this is the tubulin protein, and this protein has two subunit. You can see it is very much clear, where they are shown with different color, alpha subunit and beta subunit. So remember, children, this is very important. Microtubule is a cytoskeletal structure, and its location I have already told you. It is present in cilia, flagella, then it is present in the spindle fiber, and they are made up of tubulin protein, and the tubulin protein consists of two subunit, that is alpha and beta subunit. Okay. Now, next cytoskeletal structure is microfilament. It was discovered by Palvis et al. In 1974. So, these are also microscopic, small and long, narrow, cylindrical, and they are non-contractile proteins found in the eukaryotic cytoplasm. They are not present in prokaryote, remember, children. These are present in the microvilli. You know that in the cell, the finger-like projections are produced, that is called microvilli. So that microvilli composed of the microfilaments, they are also present in the muscle fiber. So the microfilaments present in the basically in the muscle fiber. So they are also known as myofilaments, okay? But as I have told you, they are absent in the prokaryotes, and these myofilaments are contractile proteins. The myofilaments consist of contractile proteins. This is very important, okay? So when they are present in the muscle fiber, they are composed of a contractile protein, that is mainly made up of actin. Actin and myosin are the two contractile protein which constitute the muscle fiber. So it is mainly composed of the actin protein. Now let us discuss the function of microfilaments. It forms a part of cytoskeleton. So it helps in changing the shape of the cell, maintaining the shape of the cell. It helps in the motility as well as division of the cell during development. Okay, during embryonic development, the zygote undergoes the division, mitotic division. So at that time, the microfilaments help in division of the cell. Okay, besides that, the microfilament helps in directed movement, that means in a particular direction. It helps in the movement of the particles and the organelles in the cell. So, in a cell, different organelles and inclusion bodies are there. So, these organelles and particles are moving inside the cell as per the requirements. So, in which direction these organelles and particles have to move? That is done by microfilaments. So, this is the picture of microfilament. Rather, I can say this is myofilament. It is a filament-like structure. And it is, as I have told you, that is they are made up of actin protein present in muscle fiber, and they are contractile. They are in muscle fiber, they are contractile protein. So now you can see that they may be present in fragmented condition, that is known as G-actin. So G-actin means globular actin. So these are the actin proteins which are present in globular form. But in globular form, they are non-functional. But when in a muscle fiber, they join together to form a filamentous structure, then it becomes the filamentous actin or F-actin. The F-actin helps in contraction of the muscle. Now, the next type of cytoskeletal structure is intermediate filaments. These are the supportive elements like the microfilaments and the microtubules, and very important, children, this is absent in mammalian RBC. So these intermediate filaments are larger than the microfilaments and are about 10 nanometer thick. These are solid, unbranched and composed of non-motile structural proteins like keratin, desmin, vimentin. So these are different types of protein. So what is the function of intermediate filaments? So as usual, it is the cytoskeletal structure. So it provides a shape to the cell, maintains shape to the cell, and it also supports the fluid present in the cytoplasm. And they provide support to the myofibrils, which is essential for their contraction. Okay, myofibrils are present in the muscles. So, it supports the myofibrils. It provides support to the myofibrils for their contraction. So, here all the three types of cytoskeletal structures are present, and you can differentiate according to their size and also the protein present in them. The microtubules are bit thicker, their diameter is 25 nanometer. Then the next one is microfilaments, which are also known as actin filaments because they are made up of actin protein. So these actin proteins are non-contractile, but in muscle when they form F-actin, they become filamentous and they are contractile protein. The filament can contract, and it is thinner than the microtubules. Its diameter is about 7 nanometer. Then intermediate filament, its thickness is intermediate between the microtubules and the actin filaments or the microfilaments, that is your 10 nanometer its diameter. Now, I have told you that the microtubules forms the cilia and flagella. These cilia and flagella are the appendages developed in some of the cells. So, the singular of cilia is called cilium and the singular of flagella is called flagellum. So, these are the hair-like outgrowth. The cilia are the small hair-like structures developed from the cell membrane, and flagella are the whip-like outgrowths developed from the cell membrane. So, the flagella are bigger than the cilia. The cilia are responsible for movement of the cell or the surrounding fluid. It also helps in feeding. The flagella are also responsible for the movement of the cell. Now here is the structure of cilia and flagella. I will show you the diagram and I will explain the detailed structure of cilia and flagella. Both cilia and flagella have similar structure, but only they vary in their size and number. So both of them have the four parts, that is basal body, rootlets, basal plate and sac. The basal body is that part which is present below the plasma membrane, that is in the cytoplasm. And this, its structure, the structure of basal body is similar to centriole. I will tell you the structure of centriole, explain you. So, I will be showing you the picture so that it will be clear. Then rootlets. It is made up of the microfilaments and it provides support to the basal body. Then basal plate, it is present above the plasma membrane. Then the most important part is the sac. It is the hair-like projecting part of the cilia and flagella, which remains outside the cytoplasm. And it has 9 doublet of microtubules in radial symmetry. These are called axonema. And each axonema has 11 fibrils, that is 9 plus 2 pattern. I will show you what is 9 plus 2 pattern. So, the chemically, the cilia and flagella are composed of the central tubules, that is central tubule that is made up of a dynein protein, and the peripheral tubules are made up of the microtubules, which is made up of tubulin protein. So let me show you the picture so that it will be clear. So this is the shaft, I can say this is the cross section of the flagella or cilia. So here you can see that I have told you that they have they are also membrane bound structure, the plasma, because it is the outgrowth from the cell. So it is developed from the cytoplasm by the accumulation of the microtubules. So if you take the section of the this cilia or flagella, you will see the arrangement of the microtubules in this way. So this is called, as I have told you that, let me again explain. The hair-like projecting part of cilia is a shaft, and the shaft has 9 doublet of microtubules. Okay, so these are doublet. So a pair of microtubules are there. So each one is microtubule. So here you can see 9 doublet of microtubules, and what I have told you, and these microtubules are called axonema, and they are arranged radially. Okay, and now you can see that this structure is axonema. This arrangement is called axonema. So 9 doublet plus 2 at the center, which are not forming doublet, they are individually present. So this is the central microtubules, and these are the peripheral 9 doublet microtubules. So all together 9 microtubules are there, 11 microtubules are there, that is 9 plus 2. Okay, 9 doublet and 2 individual microtubules are there. Okay, and they are connected with the central microtubules with the radial spokes, which are made up of the microfilaments. Besides that, I have told you about the dynein protein. So from this, the small hair like dynein proteins are attached, okay, from each of the doublet of the microtubules. Then the whole structure is called axoneme, and the axoneme is surrounded by plasma membrane. Okay, so each doublet consists of two microtubules, so it is A tubule and B tubule, and the dynein proteins are attached to the that is A tubule. Okay, so this is the structure of that is the you can say the anatomy of or the internal structure of cilia and flagella. Now externally how they appear? The flagella are usually less in number, they are whip like, bigger than the cilia, but the cilia are always present in large number and they are small hair like fine hair like structures, and they are present in large numbers, and both of them help in locomotion, but the cilia helps in capturing the food and also directing the food particle into the body of the cell. Okay, and they are generally found in the unicellular organisms as well as some cells of our body. Just as you know that ciliated epithelial tissue, the cells of ciliated epithelial tissue are also having the cilia. Okay, so let us discuss some of the differences between cilia and flagella, but before that we'll discuss their function. They help in locomotion, respiration, cleaning, circulation, feeding, and they show sensitivity to change in light, temperature and contact in unicellular organisms. So these are the differences between cilia and flagella. The cilia are small in size, as I have shown you, they are 5 to 10 micrometer, while as flagella are long and their size may be up to 150 micrometer. The cilia are more in numbers, may be up to 14,000 per cell, but flagella are few in number. It may vary from, its number varies from 1 to 8, maximum 8 number of flagella may be there. Now the next thing is cilia beats in a coordinated manner. So here in this picture you can see that there is a particular coordinated way the cilia are moving. But in flagella no such coordinated movement is there. Okay, so the cilia move in a particular pattern. So that is the difference. The flagella beats independently, and the cilia helps in locomotion, feeding, attachment, but flagella helps only in locomotion. Now the next structure, the most important structure that is present only in animal cell. Remember children, this is very very important, often asked in the exam, which cell organelle is present only in animal cell, that is centrosome. So, centrosome was first discovered by Van Benden in 1887, and the structure was explained by T. Boveri. It is a cell organelle which is composed of two cylindrical structure, that is centriole. Let me show you the picture. So, these two are, this is one cylindrical structure, this is another cylindrical structure. These two are together surrounded by an amorphous membrane. So here you can see this is the structure of a centrosome. The centrosome, inside the centrosome, two cylindrical structures present which are called centriole. So the centrosomes are is present at the pole of the nucleus or near the nucleus. Okay, so these are the two cylindrical structure present inside the centrosome, and the centriole are not surrounded by any membrane, but both the centriole are surrounded by an amorphous membrane. Okay, powder like membrane, and that structure is called centrosome. Okay, so these two centrioles are present perpendicular or right angle to each other, their organization is like the cartwheel. They are made up of 9 evenly spaced peripheral fibrils of tubulin, that is microtubules. Each of the peripheral fibril is a triplet. Okay, so let me show you. So these are two centrioles, so they are present at right angle to each other. So if you look into the structure of the centriole, you can see that here are the, in cilia and flagella, there is doublet of tubulin protein. But here, the triplet of tubulin protein is there. And besides that, at the center, there is no tubulin protein. Okay. So, as I have explained here, that is, in case of cilia and flagella, at the center, two microtubules are there. So, 9 plus 2 tubular, that is fibrillar pattern is there. But here, only 9 microtubules, and each microtubule is a triplet of tubulin protein. So, is it clear? I think it is clear to you. And cilia and flagella, they have also the spikes. These are the spikes. They are arranged radially. And at the center, a proteinaceous structure is present, that is called hub. This is called hub. And the whole structure, in case of cilia and flagella, the whole structure, a cylindrical structure, is called axoneme, and that is surrounded by plasma membrane. But in case of centriole, no membrane is there around the centriole. So, I hope the structure of centriole and centrosome is clear to you. So, if it will not be clear to you, then please pause the video and listen to me whatever I am saying. So, this is centrosome, which is present the near the nucleus, and inside the centrosome, there are two centriole, and these centrioles are not surrounded by any membrane, but the centrosome is surrounded by amorphous membrane, that is powder like membrane, powdery substance is there, and this is the difference between centrosome and centriole. Now, what is the function of centriole? It helps in the formation of spindle fiber. So, here you can see the centriole, they are made up of the tubulin protein. So, the tubulin protein forms a fiber, forms a number of fibers, that is called spindle fiber. So, these are the spindle fiber, and you can observe that the spindle fibers are attached to the chromosome, the central part of the chromosome. So, they help in the movement of the chromosome in a specific manner during cell division. Okay. They provide basal bodies which give rise to cilia and flagella. So, I have told you that the cilia and flagella are developed from the cytoplasm. Actually, they form the, I have told you that the cilia and flagella has basal body. So, this basal body is formed by the centriole. Okay. So, the microtubules of the centriole forms the basal body of the cilia and flagella. Then, the rest of the portion of the flagella and cilia are formed. So, the cilia and flagella are formed from the centriole of the cytoplasm. Now, the most important part, the control room or brain of the cell, is nucleus. It is the most important part of the cell which controls all the activities of the cell. It was first described by Robert Brown in 1831. Some mature cells do not have a nucleus like RBC of many mammals, that is all mammals except camel. They are also absent in sieve tube cells of the plants. The sieve tube are the components of the phloem, you know that. So, a typical nucleus consists of various structures. So, this is the structure of a typical nucleus, and you can see that near the nucleus, the endoplasmic reticulum is there, and this portion is the nucleus. The nucleus has nuclear envelope, then inside the nucleus, the nuclear envelope is having small pores. These pores are called nuclear pores. So, we'll discuss one by one in details. Then inside the nucleus, the nucleolus is present, chromatin fibers are present. So, let us discuss each and every part of the nucleus in detail. So, the first part is the nuclear membrane. The nuclear membrane is also called nuclear envelope, which consists of two parallel membrane with a space of about 10 to 50 nanometer. And the space between these two membrane is called perinuclear space. Okay. And this separates the materials of nucleus and the cytoplasm. The outer membrane is usually continuous with the endoplasmic reticulum, as you have seen here. So here you can see that this is outer membrane, this is inner membrane. In between these two, perinuclear space is there, but the outer membrane is continued with the endoplasmic reticulum. Okay, and at regular interval, some minute pores are present, as I have shown you. So these pores are formed by the fusion of the two membrane. Okay, and what is the function of nuclear membrane? It helps in passes of inorganic ions, small organic molecules, ribosomal subunits, RNAs and proteins through the nuclear pore. Okay, so it helps in transportation of the substances or materials from nucleus to cytoplasm, and it also maintains the shape of the nucleus. So here is the detailed structure of the membrane. So these are the two membranes. This is outer membrane, this is inner membrane. In between them, the space is present, that is called perinuclear space. Then here you can see the nuclear pore is there. The nuclear pore, these are nuclear pore. So through these nuclear pore, the ribosomes, the fragments of ribosomes which are synthesized in the nucleus are released out into the cytoplasm. The RNA from the nucleus, the ions, the other organic compounds are also transported from cytoplasm to nucleus. So this helps in exchange of the materials between nuclear membrane and the cytoplasm. Now the next structure is nucleus. It is a very clear and darkly stained spherical body present in the nucleoplasm. Okay, and it is composed of a large amount of ribosomal protein and ribosomal RNA, and it is associated with the nuclear organizer region. Actually, in a chromosome, there is a part that is called nucleolar organizer, which forms the nucleolus. And this nucleolus synthesizes rRNA. The RNA is of three types: rRNA, ribosomal RNA; tRNA, transfer RNA; and mRNA, messenger RNA. The rRNA forms the ribosome. So the rRNA and the ribosomal units, discussing ribosome, I have told you what are the composition of ribosome. It is composed of rRNA, that is the ribosomal RNA, and some other ribosomal fragments and some other enzyme. So actually, the ribosomal fragments, the ribosome has two fragments, two subunits, that is larger and smaller subunit. Again, these larger and smaller subunits are composed of many small subunits. So these subunits are synthesized in the nucleolus. Okay, and besides that, the nucleolus also help in the formation of spindle formation. Okay. So this is the structure of nucleolus. This is the nucleolus present inside the nucleoplasm. So this matrix, this is the matrix of the nucleolus and of the nucleus, in which the nucleolus is a spherical structure which is present and which synthesizes the rRNA and ribosomal subunit. Then the next structure is nucleoplasm. This is the transparent, homogeneous, semi-fluid, that is colloidal ground substance present inside the in the nucleus, which is enclosed by the nuclear membrane, and it helps in maintaining the shape of the nucleus and also formation of the spindle protein, and that is spindle protein of NAD, ATP, DNA, RNA, and ribosomal subunits. So you can see here, this is the structure of nucleus. This is nucleolus, and inside the nucleolus, the subunits of ribosomes are there, and rRNA are there. This dark pink color structures, dot-like structures are there. Then here you can see that this portion consists of a transparent semi-fluid structure that is called nucleoplasm. Okay. Now, in the nucleoplasm, the nuclear matrix is present, which consists of fine network of proteinaceous fibrils. Okay, that is spreaded in the whole nucleus, and it helps in maintaining the shape of the nucleus, and it also provide anchorage to the chromatin. The chromatin remains in a particular position in the nucleus due to the presence of these nuclear matrix protein. Okay. Now, the most important structure that is present inside the nucleus is the chromatin fibers, which carries the unit of heredity, that is the genes. The chromatin fibers are thread-like structures, and they are uniformly distributed in the nucleoplasm. So here you can see in this picture I have shown you that these are the chromatin fibers, and they are uniformly distributed. Okay, and these are observed, these chromatin fibers are observed in the interphase states. Okay, and the chromatin consists of DNA, RNA, histone and non-histone protein, but it is basically composed of DNA, which are forming the beaded structure with the help of the histone and non-histone protein. And this chromatin, you are very much aware of the chromatin or the chromosome, and the chromatin becomes chromosome due to its condensation during cell division. In interphase, that means in between the phase or the period between two successive cell division, in that phase the chromatin fibers are observed, but as the cell division starts, gradually the chromatin fiber condense to form the chromosome, which are thicker and more denser than the chromatin fiber. And these chromatin fibers store the genetic material. You know that the DNA is the genetic material, so it stores the genetic material, and during cell division it forms the chromosome, and the DNA protein hereditary structure, which are formed by the condensation of the chromatin fibers for the equal distribution during cell division and reproduction, are the chromosomes. So here I will show you the detailed structure of chromosome. So here you can see at the time of cell division, particularly in metaphase, the cell division had different phase that we will discuss in the cell cycle and cell division chapter. So, but all of you know what is chromosome. So this is the structure of a chromosome. And this chromosome has a central constricted part that is known as centromere, and the terminal part of the chromosome is called telomere. Remember, this is called centromere and the terminal part is called telomere, and these are the arms of the chromosome, but here the arm of the chromosome is splitted and they are known as chromatids. Now, if you so here the highlighted structure of the chromosomal arm is shown here. So when it is highlighted, you can see that inside the chromosome, the super coils of DNA, the DNA is highly coiled structure. It is forming a highly coiled structure. So here you can see this is the super coiled structure of DNA. But this supercoiled structure is not only made up of DNA, it is actually made up of the bead-like structures. The beaded structures are known as the nucleosomes, and these nucleosomes are nothing but the packaging unit of DNA. So here how the DNA are packaged, here you can see that the pink color globular structures are there. These are the histone and non-histone protein around which the DNA is wrapped. So they form a beaded structure, and when the beads are very closely packed, they form a very compact structure, and that structure is forming a super coil. Okay, so now gradually this super coil has been opened, and here the beaded structure, which are called nucleosomes, are very much clear here. So these are the packaging unit, which is composed of the histone, non-histone protein, and DNA. Okay, so now here it is uncoiled. Then you can see that these are the histone proteins and this is DNA. Okay, so now this is DNA, which is a double helical structure. The details of DNA we'll discuss in biomolecule chapter. Okay, so I think it is the structure of chromosome is clear to you. So here more clearly it is given, the chromosomal arm, it is uncoiled. So gradually you can see these are the beaded structure. They are again uncoiled, uncoiled, and here it forms the DNA. Now the types of chromosome. I have told you that the chromosome has a constriction that is called primary constriction or centromere. This is called centromere or primary constriction. Basing on the position of the primary constriction, the chromosomes are of four types. So, that centromere which is also called primary constriction. On the sides of this, the disc-shaped structure is present, which is called kinetochore. Very, very important, children. And the kinetochore is the disc-shaped portion present in the centromere. So, what are the four types of chromosome? Let me tell you. So, these are the four types of chromosome. So, here you can see that the centromere is present at the terminal part of the chromosome, chromosomal arm, and the terminal part is called telomere. That's why such chromosome is called telocentric chromosome. Then next is acrocentric chromosome. Here the centromeres are present just near the telomere, just near the terminal part of the chromosome. Okay, just bit away from the telomere. Okay, they are called acrocentric chromosome. And here I can show you the two kinetochore of the centromere. This constricted part is called primary constriction or centromere, which consists of the disc-shaped area, two disc-like structure. This is called kinetochore. Then the next type of chromosome is submetacentric. In submetacentric, the centromere is present towards the center, but not exactly at the center. They are present towards the center, but not exactly at the center, remember. Then the last one is metacentric chromosome, in which the centromere is present exactly at the center. So these are the four types of chromosome basing on the position of the centromere, and this centromere is the primary constriction, the constricted part of the chromosome, which is formed primarily. Later on, some other constrictions are also formed. They are called secondary constriction. So we are not discussing the secondary constriction here. So the primary constriction or the centromere composed of two disc-like structure, that is called kinetochore. Now we'll discuss some other vesicular structure, minute membrane bound structures, which are called microbodies. And these microbodies are present in both plant cell and animal cell, and they contain various enzymes. what are the micro these micro bodies are the small vesicular structures. Now the next cell organelle, which is found in plant cell, or we can say it is the substitute of lysosome, that is called spirosome. It is present in all, that is all plant cells, and they are involved in the storage of lipid, and they are present basically in the endosperm of the seed and cotyledon of the oil seed. And they, as I have told you, that their function is similar to lysosome. The structure is also similar to lysosome. So they contain the hydrolytic enzyme like protease, ribonuclease, phosphatase, which has in the or you can say the spirosome is the suicidal bag of the plant cell. Okay, so this is the structure of a spirosome. So the spirosome composed of the membrane like structure, okay, whose composition is similar to that of plasma membrane. It is a vesicular structure inside which you can see that the hydrolytic enzymes are there, as it is seen in case of your lysosome. And besides that, they have glycosylate, that is glycosylate membrane transport proteins are projected out of the membrane. This is the special feature of the spirosome. Then the next cell organelle is peroxisome. They are also known as uricosomes. They are called peroxisome because they contain peroxide producing enzymes, that is oxidase, and peroxide destroying enzymes, that is called catalases. Okay, and they are found in all photosynthetic cells of plants, and these peroxisomes are found in the cells of liver, kidney, brain, small intestine, testes, and adrenal cortex, and in invertebrates and protozoan also they are found. And this membrane is permeable to the membrane of peroxisome is permeable to amino acid, uric acid. That's why they are known as uricosome. They contain four enzymes of peroxide metabolism. The enzyme urate oxidase is present inside it, which catalyzes the synthesis and breakdown of peroxide. That's why it is known as uricosome. Okay, so this is the structure of peroxisome. Here you can see it has a lipid membrane. The membrane is not like that of the other membrane of the other cell organelles. Rather, it is made up of a lipid membrane. Here is the matrix. The matrix contains, and here is the core. Here the core and the matrix contains the similar substance, but here metabolically the core is, the matrix is more active, and the core is having the enzymes, all the enzymes that is required for peroxide breakdown and synthesis. Then the next structure is glyoxysome. These are found in fungi, some protist and germinating fatty seeds, where insoluble lipid food reserves must be turned into soluble sugar. So their function is to convert the lipid to soluble sugar. That's why they are known as glyoxysome. That means they oxidize the lipid and convert them into the carbohydrate. But they are absent in animal cells, and they contain the enzyme for the metabolism of glycolic acid via glycosylate cycle. So it is in higher class you will read about this, so I am not discussing much about this. So glyoxysome is a structure that is help present in plant cells and fungi and protists, and they help in converting the lipid food reserves into soluble sugar. This much only you remember, children. Okay, so I think the whole cell chapter is clear to you, the structure, the cell organelles, their function, and especially in this session, the microbodies are very new to you. Cytoskeletal structures are also new to you. But the nucleus, somehow you have studied in your class 9th. So you know a little bit about the nucleus. But I hope you understood everything in this cell chapter. And this is the end of the chapter. Thank you all for watching the video till end. Thank you once again. Thank you.